We need some refreshment. You know what? It's been a long, hot summer, and even the heat puts a little stress on our marriages, you know? It does at my house because we fight over the thermostat. So we need some times of refreshment. Everyone goes through the same thing, I think. So we're going to just spend these few weeks, and then sometime in September, we're going to begin our study of the book of Romans. So let's dive in this morning, look at these two very classic verses from the Apostle Paul in the book of Ephesians. As he writes, he says, quoting now the Old Testament, the book of Genesis, he says, "For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh." Now this is a great mystery. Great mystery. Amen? It's a great mystery. But I speak concerning Christ and the church. You know, when our youngest grandson, Bailey, finally learned to walk, he discovered that a whole new world at, you know, that altitude of 20 inches. And one of the things he discovered at our house was this piece of, it's a decorative chess set that Carla we keep on our table, coffee table in the family room. And it seemed every time Bailey came over, he zoomed in on that chess set. Now, neither one of us play chess. It's just there to look good. It's a really nice looking piece. But he zoomed in on that chess set, and he would ultimately, with his little hands, he would just crash the whole thing. And so we worked with him and worked with him, trying to get him to leave our, you know, Carla's things. That was off limits for our grandkids. You could do lots of things at our house, but don't mess with, you know, her decorations. So, but I learned quickly that the best way to reset that chess table was just to clear the table and then put all the pieces back one at a time. And I don't know how many times I had to do that before Ethan learned to leave our chess set alone. Now, here's my point. Hey, let's, for the next several weeks, let's just push reset. All right? Let's clear the table, and let's put the players and all the pieces back together, piece by piece, as we look into God's Word and discover what God teaches us about this complex relationship that we call marriage, and then the complexities of having children and trying to build a sane family life in this culture of ours. Well, guys, listen. A lot of changes have taken place in our culture over the last 100 years, even the last 30 years. And sadly, many Christians have bought into the lies and the trends of our culture. And we have begun to think these things are the norm, and they're not. And then there's the spirit of the age that's constantly, we're constantly bombarded with. And we have to wake up to these things. And we need to look again for a few weeks and have a fresh approach to marriage and family. Now, guys, if you have divorce in your past, a broken relationship, this month, this series is not to beat down on you. It's to encourage you. By the way, rejoice this morning that God forgives us all of our mistakes we make in the past. And if God can set those things aside, we should be able to do that as well. So be encouraged today. Now look, let me start with one just very basic thing that I've discovered, and Carl and I both know, and most of you know too. Marriage is glorious, but it is really hard. You know, I didn't realize it, but I kept thinking our anniversary in June was our 38th, but last June we celebrated 39 years, and that means next year we will have been married 40 years. And it has really gone by fast. But guys, your pastor and his wife, we don't have a perfect marriage. We have a healthy marriage, but it's not perfect. But there's no such thing as a perfect marriage. And over these almost 40 years, we've had to just pound out a relationship at times. It's taken a lot of work. I've often told Carla, look, babe, if you ever decide to leave me, that's my name for her, babe. I call her babe most of the time. If I call her Carla, usually she's in trouble. But I say, babe, if you ever decide to leave me, you pack my bags too, because I'm going with you. I mean, it's just been, I've invested too much emotional energy into this relationship. I'm not about to start over. And so, you know, we understand. We're just like you. And if you're married, you'll agree with me that making marriage work requires a lot of emotional energy. And some days you fall into bed at night and you say to yourself, I don't know how that happened. I mean, how did the day turn out the way it did? I mean, we started out good and everything was just great. And then the conversation, it just went south. And you go to bed frustrated again. Lord, we got to start over tomorrow. You know, there's a scripture that says, don't let the sun go down on your wrath. I've heard people say, they just stayed up for days, you know. They took that scripture literally and they lost days of sleep, you know. It's hard. Marriage is hard. Listen, we all experience the frustration that comes from our attempts to make relationships, not just marriage, but all relationships we have in life, to make them work. And yet, according to the Bible, and I believe this to be true, there's no relationship between human beings that is greater and more important than marriage. So, it's not surprising that the only phrase in this famous discourse of the Apostle Paul in Ephesians 5 that most couples can relate to is that phrase, this is a great mystery. A man shall leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is, some texts say, a profound mystery. Now look, when Paul says mystery there, he's not saying, hey, this is a deep, dark secret that only a few special people are privileged to understand. That's not what he means when he says this is a profound mystery. He means something else, and I'm going to show that to you this morning. And secondly, I want you to know, as I was praying weeks ago about this topic, and I pray every week, I pray for different people in this church, and you know that because you get cards from me that I'm praying for you, and I pray for our marriages, and I pray as I prayed for my marriage, and I've been praying for your marriage. God kept bringing me back to this. Just this glorious reality, and I'm so thankful for it. The glorious reality that my marriage, your marriage, and this church belongs to Christ. And you know, sometimes some of my anxiety that I experience in my life as a pastor has to do with church and church members and just the church. This is hard. It's a hard profession. But when I get peace, it's when God reminds me, it's not your church. It's Christ's church. And this marriage of yours is my marriage. I'm refreshed by that. And I want you to be refreshed by that as well. We look into the Bible, into the first book of the Bible, in Genesis chapter 2, and what we discover in Genesis 2, I want you to turn there, Genesis 2. It's an easy book to find. I didn't even have to mark it this morning. Genesis 2. And here we see where God officiates the first marriage. See, this is a fundamental truth. Marriage is not man's idea. It's God's idea. And he officiated the first marriage. And listen, after God gives Adam his wife, Eve, listen to what Adam said in verse 23. And Adam said, This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of me. This is bone of my bone, Adam said. In one sense, Adam is saying, finally, at last, here's someone compatible to me. He had named all the animals in the kingdom. He had been a very busy guy. But God knew he was lonely. It's not good, God said. That's the first malediction in the Bible in Genesis. It's not good that man should be alone. So I'm going to make someone suitable for him. And so God made woman. And I've heard some preachers translate that. Wow, man. I don't think that's the correct Hebrew. But what the point is, here is the first poetry in the Bible at the first wedding when Adam is married, brought into communion, union with Eve. And he's like saying, finally, at last, I have someone that's compatible to me. I have a soulmate. And God officiates this marriage. Now, guys, like knowing God Himself, coming to know and love your spouse is one of, if not, the most important and painful challenges you will face in this life. And yet, the most rewarding and wondrous journey you'll ever take. Now look, if you're single here, and I know we have some young ladies who are coming of age, and we have one that's going off to college here in a few weeks, and those days are coming for many of our children. This stuff will be good for you. Listen to this. If you're single, and maybe you're beginning to think, hey, I'll never find the right person, or you're already started to worry about whether I'm going to find that right man or woman for my life, or you're married and miserable, and you're thinking about, hey, I'm going to get out of this, I want you to listen to me this morning. Giving up on marriage simply because you don't want to lose your freedom, or you have fears that it might be just too hard, that's one of the worst things you can do to your heart. C.S. Lewis, and most of you know his story, a man who remained single most of his life. He didn't marry until late in his life, and then he only had his precious wife for just a few short years. She was overcome, and she died with cancer. But listen to what he wrote about the human heart. Lewis said this, love anything, and your heart will certainly be wrong and possibly broken. If you want to make sure of keeping your heart intact, you must give your heart to no one, not even to an animal. Wrap it carefully round with hobbies and little luxuries. Avoid all entanglements. Look it up, or lock it up safe in the casket or coffin of your selfishness. But in that casket, safe, dark, motionless, airless, it will change. It will not be broken. It will become unbreakable, impenetrable, irredeemable. Then he says this, the alternative to tragedy, or at least the risk of tragedy, is damnation. So you might be thinking this morning, I mean, this doesn't apply to me because I don't believe in divorce, and I'm just going to endure this mess that I'm in. I'm just going to try to make the best of a bad situation. Let me tell you something. I learned this many years ago. I've never forgotten it. When it comes to marriage, the marriage relationship, the opposite of love is not hate. It's indifference. Beware of that attitude of indifference. You remain indifferent long enough, and your heart too will eventually harden. And you'll end up to be a lonely person. Now, I want to talk a few minutes this morning before I get to go back to the text and show you one of the fundamental first things we need to grab hold of in our series. Before I show you that, back in Ephesians 5, I want to just show you, tell you, how we got to where we are today. The decline of marriage and family in the United States. This is interesting. And it'll help you understand what's going on right now in your lives. When I was born in 1956, the divorce rate was just under 25%. 1970, 89% of all births were to married parents. That's in 1970. Now, I looked this up again last night just to make sure it hadn't changed too drastically. It has changed some. It's going in the negative direction. But anyways, I looked it up again last night. Today, only less, under 60% of babies born in the United States are born to couples, married parents. That means over 40% of the children born in our country are born single-parent families. If you want to look up some of these stats, you can go to childtrends.com this afternoon and verify what I'm telling you today. But here's the most telling stat when it comes to the decline of marriage in this country. Over 72% of American adults were married in 1960. Today, it's less than 40%. Now, all of this reveals a growing pessimism about marriage in our culture, especially among young adults. Our young adults that are coming of age, they're convinced that their chances of having a good marriage are not great. And even if their marriage turns out stable, there's this horrifying prospect that many of them have that it will become sexually boring. As one comedian put it, do you want to be single and lonely or married and bored? And our young adults think that's the two options I have. If I remain single, I'm going to be lonely. If I get married, ultimately I'll be bored. And they think, that's it. I've got those one or two choices. Now listen, over the years, as this view of marriage has declined in this country, this has resulted in a new phenomenon in our country that started, it really started peaking about 30 years ago. Young adults began to look for something in the middle. What kind of relationship can I enter into that will protect me from being lonely, protect me from that, and also protect me from being hurt? And that growing phenomenon, it's still growing today. It's called cohabitation. My childhood pastor, when he interviewed couples who wanted to get married, he never had to ask the question, are you living together? It just wasn't happening. Today, it's the first thing I ask. When couples come to me and they want me to do their wedding, that's the first thing I ask. Are you living together? Because if they are and they want me to do their wedding, a Christian ceremony, I've got some requirements of them. And you know what? Most of the time, they won't agree to them. And I don't do their marriage. Cohabitation has grown exponentially in the last three decades. Today, more than half of all couples live together before getting married. Again, in 1960, virtually no one lived together before they married. Now, what's driving this new phenomenon? Several things. It's complicated, but let me give you a few. One of the driving forces behind this phenomenon called cohabitation is the assumption couples have that most marriages are unhappy. My parents' marriage was unhappy. I mean, most couples are coming, at least half are coming from broken homes. Secondly, living together before they marry increases their chance of making the right choice. And it also increases their chance of having a good marriage. That's what they believe. Thirdly, it's a way to discover if the other person can really keep your interest. Fourthly, many couples agree to cohabitation because they believe they need to be financially secure first, be able to buy a home and have their financial issues settled before they get married. Now look, there are other dynamics going on, but these are the major ones. And the problem with these assumptions is that most of them are false. One example is this. It has to do with finances and wealth. In 1992, a study was done on the retirement population in this country. And the result of it was an article called "The Surprising Economic Benefits of Marriage." And listen to what this study found. This was in 1992. The study shows that individuals who were continuously married had 75% more wealth at retirement than those who never married or who divorced and chose not to remarry. If you want to have a stable future and finances in those days when you're unable to work, you have a better, much better chance of staying in your marriage and making it work. And the other assumptions are false as well. We could go on and on and on, but I don't have time for that because I want to get to the real point. I want to get to what will help all of us have better marriages and more joyful families, because that's what God wants. And I firmly believe this church will never be stronger than its weakest family. So it's important. God ordained the family, and He loves His church. They belong to Christ, and we need to put all that we can into making it work. Now, here's the big question. What went wrong? What happened to cause all these social and cultural changes in our country? During the last 100 years, there's been a seismic paradigm shift in our worldview as Americans when it comes to purpose in life. Back in the 80s, Chuck Colson and John Eckert wrote a book, Why America Doesn't Work. I remember I read that book. It was fresh off the press when I got a hold of it. I read that book, and they shared something in that book that will help us understand what's happened in our country. Listen to this. According to their study, their research, in the first 100 years of our history in the United States, when young people came of age, young men became of age and they were ready to leave their father and their mother and choose a profession or a career, they typically asked this question: what can I do with my life that will allow me to give back to my community? What can I do with my life that would allow me to my work to benefit fellow man? That was the attitude the first 100 years of our country. By the way, it was during that period. Do you know what the most respected profession was in our country? Anyone want to venture? The ministry. Usually, it was the minister that was the most educated in the community. And he was highly esteemed because he was giving his life for that community to help society become strong and our families become healthy. And that was this worldview that our forefathers had. Some call it a sacramental view of marriage and family. And then Colson and Eckert revealed another trend. They discovered that within the last 100 years of our country, here was this beginning of this paradigm shift. Now, today, when young men and young women become of age and they leave their families, they finish college, or they're getting ready to choose a career and education, The question is not what can I do with my life that will most benefit my community. The question becomes, what profession can I choose that will be the easiest and allow me to make the most money? Because I want to achieve the American dream. Do you see the seismic shift in worldviews? That's the worldview that most people have today. It's a me attitude. What I need and what I deserve and what's best for me. And this shift in worldview eventually has had a tremendous direct impact on our view of marriage and family. You see, our founding forefathers had what, again, they called it a sacramental view of marriage. Marriage is ordained by God for His glory, our enjoyment, for procreation, and to benefit the broader human commonwealth. And when couples divorced in communities, it became a financial and social burden. By the way, it's still a crushing burden today. We don't get away with it even today. It still costs us tremendously. Today, marriage is seen as more a contract between two parties for mutual individual growth and satisfaction. That's the view. And in this view, married people married for themselves, not to fulfill the responsibilities to God and society. Marriage used to be a God-ordained public institution for the common good. Now, marriage is just one of many ways to find individual fulfillment. I had a young man tell me one time, he had just married, and he told me, I've given my wife some stipulations. And one of them is a weight stipulation. I told my wife, if she gets above a certain weight, it's over. I'm telling you the truth. This was just a few years ago. And you know what? The marriage ended. And there's a lot of dysfunction in that family. And it's affected the kids. The reason I know is because they're relatives of mine. Let me tell you one other important point this morning. You need to write this down. It's not really profound. It might surprise you, but you never marry the perfect person. There's no such thing. There's no such thing as the perfect marriage. So what's the solution for us? Well, the solution for us, the starting place for us, is to discover, to explore the Word of God and to learn and reaffirm in our lives what the Bible teaches us about marriage. Because if it is God's idea, and it is, it's not man's, then God has a plan and a purpose for every couple in this room. See, the Bible teaches us, for one thing, the Bible reveals to us why the quest for compatibility seems to be so impossible. I mean, if we turn to God's Word, we begin to understand human nature. And we know that that spouse we have is fallen. He's sinful. She's sinful. We have fallen natures and that we have to battle with each of us ourselves. And so right out of the gate, if you will, right after we say, I do, the battle begins. Of not fighting, but the hard work, I should say, begins of tearing down what we once knew so that something new can be built. And so this struggle for compatibility begins right after we marry. You know, people think, well, love shouldn't be so hard, should it? I mean, shouldn't love come naturally? Well, listen, you wouldn't ask a professional baseball player, to say, it shouldn't be so hard to hit a fastball, would you? Or you wouldn't expect a musician to say, it shouldn't be so hard to master the violin. So we shouldn't expect that making our marriage work, that love comes naturally, not in our fallen state. We've got to work at it and work hard. One would think that love should just come naturally if two people are compatible, but the issue is that we're not automatically compatible. The Christian answer to that is there's no such person as a perfect spouse. And guys, we never know who we marry, really. We just think we do. Even if we first marry the right spouse, just give it a while, and he or she will change, because we're in a constant state of change. And nothing, you know this, nothing will bring you into more proximity than when two human beings married. And changes are on the way. And you never know what they are. Carla has no idea what I'll be like in 10 years. You know, someone, Carla's sister sent us some pictures via email this week of 30 years ago, I guess. We were relatively newlyweds. And looking at those pictures, Carla was making fun of the shoes I had on. And I mean, where did the time go? I mean, we have changed. You know, one of the things I thought about doing was, I think somewhere in our marriage book, we have a picture. I may be wrong, but we have a picture when the day we were married, and her hand is on top of my hand, and it's sitting on a Bible or something. You know what I thought about doing is getting a retake and comparing, and you can tell the difference. You'd say, wow. Pastor Richard's hands sure are wrinkled. They are. They're getting wrinkled. I cut my arm this week, or last week before last, putting in a dishwasher in my house. I still can't get it to heal up. Carla said, we're getting old. She said, your skin is thinner than it was when we were young. We change. Just physically we change. Emotionally we're in this constant state of change. So let's look, and we'll round things up here in just a minute. Let's look back at Ephesians. The great truth that Paul is teaching to us in Ephesians chapter 5. In our text, we hear Paul declare, this is a great mystery. It could be translated this way, mega mystery. This is a great mystery. It's a mega mystery. This is a wonderful and profound truth. And it can only be understood with the help of the Holy Spirit. You see? So what is the secret? The secret of marriage? Well, Paul gives us the answer to that. He says it's a mega mystery, but he answers. He tells us what it is. What is this mega mystery? Well, he's first referred to it in verse 25. If you have your Bibles open, Ephesians 5:25. Here's the answer. The mega mystery? I'm talking about Christ and the church. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Now, it's simple, but it's profound. I mean, you're going to walk out of here this morning and you're going to take home with you the answer. I know the answer to this profound mystery that Paul was referring to. It's Christ and his church. It has to do with Christ and his church. It's the secret is not merely marriage per se. That's not what he was saying. It is the message, listen, it's the message that what husbands should do for their wives is what Jesus did to bring each of us into union with him. So husbands, listen to me this morning. What God is asking of you in this marriage union is to do for your wife what Christ did to bring her into the church. That's a sacramental view of marriage. Husbands, give yourselves up for your wives. Jesus the Son, though equal with the Father, gave up His glory and came to this earth to take on human nature. But that's not where He stopped. Jesus, the Son of God, goes to the cross and He lays Himself down. He sacrifices all that He is so that He could gather in the bride and make His bride perfect, whole, complete. Boy, this puts a lot of pressure on the husbands, doesn't it? But as we go along, I'm going to show you that this has to be a mutual thing. But the point I'm trying to make to you this morning is that we need, husbands, we need to be willing to lay down our self-wills for the good of our wives. It was a total sacrifice that Jesus made. Total. In order to make the bride whole. And one day, Jesus, you know what He's going to do? One day, He's going to have this great privilege of saying to the Father, "Here she is. Here she is. Look how beautiful she is. Look how healthy she is. Look how pure she is." And Paul is saying, husbands, that's what you need to be doing. That should be your view of marriage, your attitude when it comes to your wife. I'm willing to lay down my own self-will for my wife. Listen to what Paul said in Romans 15, 1 through 3. I think this will be on the screen. "We then who are strong." You know, when I read a lot of these passages and they're general passages to the church, you can also say, make them more personal. And I can read this passage as a husband. And I can say, then, Richard, you who are strong, you need to bear with the scruples or the doubts or the hesitations of your wife. Those who are weak, And don't please yourself. But you need to please your neighbor. And you know, my closest neighbor is my wife. I have lots of neighbors. My closest one, my favorite, my best is my wife. And so I need to please my wife for her good, leading to what? Edification. Wholeness. And then he goes on to say, "For even Christ did not please himself. But as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproached you fell on me." So Jesus gave himself up for us so that we might be brought into deep union with him, inextricably linked together. And Paul says, this is the key, not only to understanding marriage, but to living it. If you're going to live it, you got to get this. If you're going to be joyful and strong and grow together, you got to get this. Now let me frame it another way. Paul saw, you know, where's Paul getting this? The Old Testament. That's what he studied. He was a student of the Old Testament. And what Paul saw was when God designed marriage, God already had the church in mind. And God said, I'm going to give Adam and Eve, I'm going to give the human race a relationship that will be so powerful and so meaningful, yet it's going to be difficult, but it's going to be so worthwhile because it will be a human picture of Christ and His church. And so when I tell couples who are about to get married, and I'm saying, you're about to make a marriage covenant, and it needs to be one that will last forever, because if it does, you know what it will do? It will teach your children that God is a covenant-keeping God. He keeps His promises. And marriages, Christian marriages, are to be that to this world, this broken world that we live in. The day after Carl and I married, we married on a Friday. I've shared some of this with you in sermons past, but we married on a Friday, and because of my work, we had to delay our really expensive honeymoon. I won't tell you where that is, but we'll talk about that in private. But anyway, we had to delay that honeymoon, and the next morning we got up and we went to the grocery store. We didn't have anything in this apartment that we had already rented, and it just nothing there. And so we had to go get everything and all the staples. I mean, and I will never forget that day, that Saturday morning. I'm standing there and Carla is pushing the basket and she rounds this corner and she's going up the aisle and I'm a few paces back, and that's when it hit me. Now, I think it might have been my first real anxiety attack. I'm serious. I was scared to death. And I thought, I didn't say it out loud, but I said, what have I done? I promise you, that's what went through my head. Because I'm looking at this kid, this child that I married, and I'm saying, she's mine to take care of. It's going to be my responsibility to help her grow and mature, be safe and feel safe. And I, you know what? I was thinking, I can't do this. And that's the truth, guys. We cannot do it. We cannot do it apart from the help of the Holy Spirit. So Paul says, start here. Start here. Do for your spouse what God did for you in Jesus, and the rest will follow. This is the starting place. Lay yourself down, guys, for your wife. It's the secret. Do so that the gospel of Jesus can be proclaimed in your marriage and in your family. I'm not telling you guys that the choice is between fulfillment and sacrifice. It's not that. What I'm trying to describe to you, if you'll follow God's word, it's this. It's not, I got to choose fulfillment or sacrifice. It's mutual fulfillment through mutual sacrifice. How true. It is God's, marriage is God's major way of remaking your heart and your spouse's heart from the inside out. It's not the joining of two worlds. I tell couples, it's the tearing down of two worlds so that one new one can be built. And the reason marriage can be so painful and yet so wonderful is because it's a reflection of the gospel, which is painful and wonderful at once. Through our marriage, God is making something beautiful. We can't see it right now. You may be going through a very, very difficult time in your marriage right now. Hang in there. Let the Holy Spirit do a work in your life. Lay down your life for your spouse, and something beautiful will happen. And it won't happen in a year. It won't happen in 10 years. It's not even really fully happened in our lives yet, after 40 years of marriage, but it's coming. God will make it worth all you put into it. Remember, it's His marriage, His family, His church. I'm going to show you a powerful video Wade sent to me when I told him I was going to preach this series. I said, we got to show this the first Sunday. Because it's true. You know what? Carl and I, we know this. We're broken. Broken together. Watch this video. Bow your heads with me this morning, and I'm going to ask you to do something a little different today. If your spouse is here today and he or she is sitting close enough, would you take her hand or his hand? Here's the question I want to propose this morning to all of us. What am I doing each day for my spouse that involves sacrifice? Let me remind you that true sacrifice will always cost you something. And it can start with just the little things. There's so many examples. I've been going through my mind this week, so many things that I could do and stop doing. And stop insisting. And say, what's the big deal? And then start with this prayer today. I really believe we all need this. We need to recover our sense of sacrifice in all areas of our lives as Christians. And let's make that our prayer this month as we go through this marriage series. Let's start with this prayer. Father, help me recover my sense of sacrifice. And guys, that applies to all kinds of relationships. It certainly applies to your attitude toward the church, your church. I mean, Wade and I were talking this morning, broken together. That describes every relationship we have in this life. It certainly describes Hope Community Church. This is not a perfect church. It's so far from it. We're just broken people. Can we not be broken together? Learn to sacrifice and That also can include overlooking someone's faults, because we all have them. And instead of talking about someone's faults, praying for them and loving them in Christ. You see how it all goes together? And it's through that process that we're being conformed to the image of Christ. And as we grow in these broken relationships, the world begins to really see something different in us. First of all, our children, our grandchildren. I mean, I want my grandsons, when they're old one day, to say, boy, my pop sure did love Lolly. And God will use that in their lives to bring them to Christ. Father, we thank you so much for the beauty and the glorious institution of marriage. Forgive us, Father, for being passive and indifferent and consumed with our works and making money, pleasures, hobbies. Nothing wrong, Lord, with those things, but sometimes they consume us and we put our spouses second or third. And Lord, that affects the church. I pray, Father, you'll encourage us this month. I pray, Father, that there will be just a spirit of fresh movement of the Holy Spirit in this church. And we'll just give you the glory for it. Thank you for all these people sitting out here this morning in front of me. Bless them. Bless their marriages. Bless their relationships with co-workers and parents. So complicated, Father. Give us wisdom. How to respond. help people when they need help. Just give us wisdom in these relationships that are complex. Grow us for your glory, I pray, today. In Christ's name, amen. Would you stand with me this morning? Receive the Lord's blessings as we go. And if you need some prayer this morning, in a private context, I'm here available for you, and our elders are here and available for you. Don't rush out. We'll stay behind. I pray the Lord will bless you and He will keep you. I pray He will make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you, and He will lift up His countenance toward you, and He'll give you peace. Amen.